الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيبنا حبيب إله العالمين الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين. First of all, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, everyone. And inshallah, all of us will benefit from the blessings of these auspicious days, especially the blessings of Fatimah al-Zahra, salamullah alayha, who is the Siddiqa of our Ummah, as Maryam was Siddiqa of the Ummah of Banu Israel. There is one hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, alayhi salam, which is very famous, and he says that لفاطمة عند الله تسعة أسماء. Fatima has nine names with Allah. Fatima and Siddiqa and Mubarakah and Tahira and Zakiya and Raziya and Marziya and Zahra and Zakiya. These are the names that Fatima has with Allah. Now, of course, name is not something very important. And when Imam alayhi salam says these are the names of Fatima with Allah, means that these are real qualities. These are not just names that we give to our children. Sometimes we give a name to our child, like, for example, Saleh means righteous, or, for example, Siddiqa means truthful. But these are names, and we hope that inshallah they somehow fulfill these names in their endeavor in life. They become truthful, they become righteous. But when Imam alayhi salam says that Fatima has these names with Allah, means that in that realm she's known by these qualities. And these qualities, of course, are very spiritually highly esteemed in the eyes of Allah and His awliya. So one of these names is Raziya, the one who's content. And it is, of course, always Raziya and Marziya are together. If you are content with God, God is pleased with you. If God is pleased with you, you are content with God. Contentment is something that brings felicity to life, whether in this world or in the next world. And this is one of the things that most of us don't have. We are not content about our situation. We are not content about many things in life. And it doesn't matter how much we have. It doesn't matter how many blessings we receive. Contentment is a quality of heart. It's not something which comes from our belongings, our possession, whatever we have. Someone may be very poor but very content. Someone may be very rich but very greedy and not content at all. So contentment is when a person establishes a relation with God which gives all the will, the desire, the aspirations, they let God to lead them in these things. And when they actually rely on God and give these things to God, they are very content. No matter what happens, they are very content. And in this sense, of course, because they are resonating with God's will, God is pleased with them. Inshallah, all of us will attain this later on when God calls us to paradise. But some of us should have to go through bumpy roads to achieve this. Some of us achieve this in this world, and then we are very happy and have a very easy journey after life. Some of us have more difficult ones. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutma'inna, irji'i ila rabbika radiyatan marziya. Any soul who wants to go to God should have this quality, should be content, This is the quality of Ahlul Jannah. They have to be content, otherwise they cannot enter paradise. If they are not content, it means that they have greed, it means they have some sort of troubled heart with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not possible. So any soul who wants to enter paradise should be content, and Allah is pleased with them. So the quality is very important. And the root of it is you resonate with Allah. And this is the meaning of worship, ibadah. Ibadah is that you resonate with God, you comply with Him. It's not that worship in the sense, maybe worship is not the right term as a translation for ibadah. Ibadah means compliance. When we have an abd and a mawla, the abd complies with the mawla, with whatever he says. And وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created jinn and ins but to worship, or but to do be abd of me, or do ibadah of me. Means they have to resonate with me. If they resonate, then they easily go to his neighborhood. If they don't resonate, then there's friction. Then they fall out. And this followed because anything but Allah is batil, they go into batil. Let me give you one very beautiful example. There was this great scholar and great spiritual man, Abu Hamza al-Thumali, to whom all of us are indebted because of the dua that he reports from Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. Maybe we only know him because of his duas, of his dua, that dua that he has reported from Imam Zain al-Abidin. However, he was a great scholar. He was one of those people who, one of the first people who wrote a tafsir on Quran, and was a jurist, and was a companion of Imam Sajjad, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, and Imam al-Kazim. So when Imam taught him this dua, he was certainly quite young, but because of his pure soul, he could actually, Imam found him capable of teaching him this dua, which has remained as one of our treasures. And Allah knows how many people through this dua have somehow set out on a spiritual journey to him. Anyhow, he had a daughter that one day she fell, very young. She fell and her hand broke. And he took him to the doctor. The doctor examined her hand and said that it's broken. And the girl was crying. I said, I go to bring the jabair. Jabair were these woods and things which they put on hand, like plaster. Today we put plaster. That day they were jabira. Jabira, the plural was jabair. And this wuzu jabira that you make is just when there is something like plaster or anything on your hand or any other place that you have to somehow wipe on it. Anyhow, he went to bring the jabair, and when he came out, he took the hand which was broken, and examined. It was okay. And the other hand, it was okay. He said, I'm surprised. Now, Abu Hamza says, while the doctor went to bring the jabair, my heart broke, my daughter was crying, and I started to cry as well because of my daughter. And I said, Ya Allah, you give her Shafa. And the doctor came out, Shafa had come. He was very surprised. Abu Hamza himself was very surprised. And he says that I mentioned this to Imam Jafar al-Sadiq. I said, this is what happened. My daughter's hand broke and I took her to the doctor, and before he put in jabair, then it was healed. I just prayed to Allah and it was done. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam said, Ya Abu Hamza, wafaqad du'a al-rida fa'ujibat bi'asra'a min tarfatayn. Your du'a resonated with the rida of Allah. Allah wanted it, you wanted it, you resonate with each other. And it was fulfilled, it was answered in more than the blink of an eye. This is what we call the intervention of Amr of Allah in Khalq. You know, Allah has a Khalq, Allah has an Amr. Khalq is a gradual process. If, for example, the hand breaks, yes, Shafa will come, but it comes gradually. It has to heal, it has to come together, it takes long time, several months, the Shafa will come. This is the Shafa through the Khalq process, creational. There's another intervention of Allah in this world, which is by command. إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ. Everything we have created with a time measure. The time should, the time that we have actually this destiny that should pass for a thing to come to existence or for a thing to process, that time should pass. Without it, it never happens. But this is not the only way we intervene. وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ كَلَمْحٍ بِالْبَصَرِ. But when I have a command, it is just one like لَمْحُ الْبَصَرِ. لَمْحُ الْبَصَرِ we translate as blink of an eye. But لَمْح is faster than blink. Blink is when you just put your eyelid on your eyes, but lam is when you just turn your eyes here and there. This is lamhul basar. It means it's instant. And sometimes people go and get shafa, for example, in Imam Reza and Imam Hussein alayhi salam or other places. This is from alamul amr. This is not from alamul khalq. When Jesus gave shafa to the lepers or to the blind, it was from alamul amr. وَإِذْ تُخْرِجُ الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِي وَإِذْ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِي. And all those things, تُبْرُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَسَ بِإِذْنِي. It was all from alamul amr. Now, this resonance, this compliance comes through ibadah. And ibadah is not just praying and fasting and going to Hajj. Of course, these are rituals. These are part of ibadah. They may be ibadah. Sometimes they are not even ibadah. Sometimes they are just sort of futile endeavor. Ibadah is something which comes from the heart. Ibadah is when you completely submit yourself to God. In that sense, whatever you do is ibadah. But for us, it is very difficult to somehow align our hearts to the will of Allah. Very difficult. Don't worry, inshallah, we go through stages and it happens. But in this life, it's very difficult. If someone can do that, if someone can do that, can align the heart to the will of Allah, that's the ibadah. There is one hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam again. He was talking to Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and it's very interesting. At the time of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, many of these Sunni scholars, very respectable Sunni scholars, came to Imam alayhi salam. They discussed about the Quran, they discussed about fiqh, they discussed about spirituality, and they actually received the views of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. And it has actually created a treasure of knowledge for us when Imam speaks to these scholars. This Sufyan ibn Uyayna was a commentator of the Quran, a jurist, and we don't know in what situation they were talking, but the hadith is addressed to Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Apparently, Imam is somehow commenting on what Sufyan was saying or was believing. About this verse, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. He created death and life, and death is mentioned before life because the important thing is that this life is transitory. It should pass. It is just a place that you grow, that's all. So death is mentioned before life because this life without death has no meaning, has no purpose. So, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. He created death and life so that to try you or to transpire that which one of you is best in action. This is the purpose of this life, the purpose of our life on the earth. Now, Imam Ali Salam said, Ya Sufyan, laysa ya'ni aktharu amala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, which one is best in action, doesn't mean which one has more action. Does more salat, for example. Does more hajj. Goes more to hajj. Does more fasting. لَيْسَ يَعْنِي أَكْثَرُ عَمَلًا. Of course, the more we do, the better, but it should be weighty. It shouldn't be very light. If it's light, if you have this room full of cotton, it's very light. But maybe a slab of iron weighs as much as all these cottons that you fill the room with. So, لَيْسَ يَعْنِي أَكْثَرُ عَمَلًا بَلْ أَصْوَبُكُمْ عَمَلًا. Which one has the most correct action? Correct. وَإِنَّمَا الْإِصَابَةِ. Then what do I mean by correct? إِنَّمَا الْإِصَابَةِ خَشْيَةُ اللَّهِ وَالنِّيَّةُ الصَّادِقَةِ وَالْحَسَنَةِ. Isaba is that you have this feeling of presence of Allah. This is the meaning of best in action. And that feeling of presence brings an awe in your heart. And then by that, your niyyah, your intention would become very truthful. You seek truth. And of course, hasana, what is good. And then he said, the Imam alayhi salam said to Sufyan, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, that وَالْبَقَاءُ عَلَى الْأَمَلِ حَتَّى يَخْلُصْ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْأَمَلِ. Continuing to do something until it becomes pure is more difficult than the act itself. It's true. Our lifetime we are praying. And as soon as we say, Allahu Akbar, we start a journey here and there. You see, it's difficult to make this act pure. To make this, it's more difficult. Praying, tell me, you now start and pray 30 rakas here, I do. Very easily, and I think about tomorrow what I'm going to do, or all these things. It's very easy. But tell me, do one rakah of salat, not thinking about anything, with khashyatullah, this is difficult. Now, we do salat during our life so that we reach this status. And that's what Imam says, al-ibqa'u ala al-amal hatta yakhlos. Continuing with an action until that act becomes pure is more difficult than the action itself. It's in this way that our hearts complies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, becomes compatible. And because there's nothing in this world but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we are not compatible, we are on battle, we go far away, we are driven away, we are just cast it away and things like that. So, there's one other thing which this resonance of heart, which this sadq and ikhlas, truthfulness and sincerity brings. And that is a type of knowledge which you cannot learn in this world. Now, by saying this, I want to just come to some aspects of knowledge of Fatima to Zahra, salamullah alayhi. It's this, when you resonate with God, first of all, whatever dua you make, it is answered quickly. is why we say Anbiya are mustajabu da'wah. Not because Allah chooses them to be a prophet, but okay, because you are a prophet, whatever dua you make, no. Because their heart resonates with Allah, they can bring down the blessings. The other thing is that they can bring down knowledge. A knowledge which is not learned in this world. A knowledge which is very different from our science and philosophy and other things. And this is one of the names of Fatimah al-Zahra, which probably I didn't mention through those nines. Did I mention eight or nine? Anyhow, Muhaddatha, Muhaddatha. This is including those nine. Muhaddatha means someone who's spoken to from the world above. And this tahdith, or sort of receiving some sort of knowledge, maybe through angels, maybe God directly talking to their hearts and minds, as Imam Ali says, وَلَا يَزَالْ فِي الْبُرْحَةِ بَعْدَ الْبُرْحَةِ وَفِي أَزْمَانِ الْفَتَرَاتِ رِجَالٌ نَاجَاهُمْ فِي فِكْرِهِمْ وَكَلَّمَهُمْ فِي ذَاتِ أُغُولِهِمْ. Although the prophethood has ended, but until the end of time, there are people that Allah speaks into the, Allah whispers into their minds and talks to their hearts. This is the knowledge which comes down. This knowledge which comes down is inclusive. Our knowledge through science or philosophy is exclusive. This knowledge is unifying. Our knowledge is diversifying from below. This knowledge which comes from above goes beyond time and space. Our knowledge is always restricted in time and space. And therefore, we see that A'imma alayhimus salam talk about things which human being ordinarily cannot know. Okay, Fatimah al-Zahra had this type of knowledge because she was a muhaddatha. And we have a hadith from the Prophet, both from Sunni and Shia, who said that in the nations before, there were people who were communicated by Allah without being prophets. And in this nation, of course, there are similar people. And we believe that our a'imma are an instance of those people. To give an instance of this knowledge of Fatimah al-Zahra, and actually showing that this knowledge was not something learned from human reading or studying or learning, it comes from above, I want to quote a short piece of his khutbah fadakiyah, the sermon that she addressed the Muhajirun and Ansar in the mosque of the Prophet. We don't have, of course, much narrations from Fatimah al-Zahra salamullah alayha, because she always was quiet, and only after the demise of the Prophet, after things happened, only two khutbahs from her are reported from us. One is the khutbah fadakiyah that she addressed the companions in the Masjid al-Nabi, and the other is when she was in bed and she was ill, and the women of Medina went to visit her, and there she started to talk to them as well. Both of them are very political. Both of them are very sensational. It shows that she was very unsatisfied with what had happened and very unhappy about the matter of Khilafah, all these things. And therefore, scarcely we have anything like this from Fatimah al-Zahra. But even though there are parts of these khutbahs, although both of them are very political, but there's one hadith from Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam in Nahj al-Balagha that says, "Al-mar'u makhbu'un tahta lisanih." A person is always hidden under their tongues. Means as long as they are quiet, you don't know what type of person is this, what is the personality. As soon as they speak, you realize the personality. We have heard about how Prophet respected Fatimah al-Zahra, how Prophet loved Fatimah al-Zahra, how he kissed her hand. But why? We didn't know. Until we heard these words from Fatimah al-Zahra, we didn't know what type of personality she is. First of all, one may ask, this khutbah Fadakiyah is about the issue of Fadak. Fadak, first of all, let me explain. Fadak was part of the lands which were taken in a battle, out of battle from the Jews of who lived close to Khaybar in Fadak. Now, the Quran says that if the Muslimun fight, and you know that all battles of the Prophet were defensive battles, or sometimes preemptive. They were defensive battles. The Quran says if the Muslimun fight in jihad to defend, and then there is any booty, the booty goes to the soldiers, one-fifth of it goes to لله وللرسول ولذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين. Those six parts, this we call it Sahmi Imam, Sahmi Sadat, one-fifth of it goes to the Prophet, and he distributes it. And nowadays, of course, to these booties are added the income which is in excess of our yearly need and such things. So if there is, let's talk about that time. If there was a battle and the soldiers fought and booties came or a land was taken, it should have been given to those who fought, except the one-fifth which was given to the Prophet to distribute among others who didn't take part in the battle. However, if there was a negotiated settlement, there wasn't a fight. For example, these people in Fadak, they negotiated with the Prophet and said, okay, we give this much of land, and we negotiate a peace. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is fay'. This is not booty anymore. And ma afa Allahu ala rasulihi min ahlil qura falillahi walil rasul walil qurba, and continue. It doesn't go to anyone. It belongs to the Prophet. Prophet should distribute. It's not the case that one-fifth of it goes to the Prophet and he distributes. No, all of it goes to the Prophet. And one part of this is for the Al-Ghurba. When this verse was revealed, the Prophet actually handed Fadak to Fatimah al-Zahra. There were several sort of villages and farms and such things. There was a yearly proceed for this. And the yearly income was enough to feed dozens of families from Banu Hashim, who were actually very poor, who didn't have any income, who didn't have any source of living. And what made the first caliph to actually take it back from Fatimah al-Zahra under any pretext made Fatima very much outraged because of those families who were being fed by this. And she thought, why? There's no reason. Why something which was given to me by the Prophet as fay, as part that Quran mentions, why is taken away? That's why. Otherwise, Imam Ali says in Nahjul Balagha, وَمَا أَسْنَعُ بِفَدَكٍ وَغَيْرِ فَدَكٍ. What do you want to do with Fadak or other than Fadak? وَالنَّفْسُ غَدًا وَالنَّفْسُ مَذَانُهَا فِي غَدًا جَدَثٌ. And tomorrow we go to just one small piece of land and we lie there. What do you want to do with Fadak? Why she was outraged? It was not the case that she was using the proceeds of Fadak. Many of Banu Hashim were using it. And that was the reason they didn't want the Fadak to stay in their hands. Now, she came to the mosque, she spoke. Of course, when she spoke, you see the literature is not an ordinary literature. The type of words used there is not the ordinary words used by an ordinary Arab person. Is highly educated language. And then in the introduction to the khutbah, usually every khutbah has an introduction, praising God, Allah, Alhamdulillah, ala ma an'am, wa lahu shukru ala ma alham, wa sana'u bima qaddam, as she mentions. Now, I just want to, three short sentences in this introduction, which is related to what I said, shows what knowledge Fatimah al-Zahra had, salamullah alayhi. After the praise of Allah, she says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Kalimatan ja'al al-ikhlasa ta'wilaha. Wa dhamman al-quluba mawsulaha. Wa anara fi tafakkure ma'agulaha. Three sentences, very short, very concise. It's an ocean of knowledge of Tawheed. Now, what she says in these three sentences. I testify that there's no Allah but God, there's no God but Allah, la ilaha illallah. This is a word, this is a sentence, kalimatan. What is the true meaning of this? What's the true meaning of la ilaha illallah? Ja'ala al-ikhlasa ta'wilaha. The true meaning of this is ikhlas, is sincere, what we talked about. You say la ilaha illallah, there is no God but Allah. It has different aspects, it has a belief aspect, it has a behavioral aspect, it has a worship aspect. All these are contained in la ilaha illallah. Ta'wil is the reality of things. We hear many things about Day of Judgment in the Quran. But these are words. We don't really know what they mean. The reality of it, as the Quran says, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا تَعْوِيلَهُ. Are they waiting for its ta'wil, for its real meaning to come on the Day of Judgment? So the reality of this La ilaha illallah is sincerity. If you are not sincere, you say La ilaha illallah morning to evening. It doesn't give you the benefits that you have to seek from it, that you are seeking from it. So the reality of La ilaha illallah should manifest itself in your action. And your action would manifest this reality by sincerity. If you are sincere in what you say in La ilaha illallah, Allah, then has manifested himself in Tawheed in your heart. So, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Look at this beautiful philosophical, mystical, theological explanation of la ilaha illallah in three short sentences. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Kalimatan ja'ala al-ikhlasa ta'wila. Wa dhammana al-quluba mawsulaha. Mawsul is something which is attached to something else or attaches two things together. For example, in Arabic we say Alladhi is Mawsul, means Ar-Rajulu Alladhi Ja'a, the man who came. This Alladhi connects Ar-Rajul to Maji, to coming. The man to the coming connects them to. What connects your heart to Allah? What is it that you believe in La ilaha illallah? Why you believe in La ilaha illallah? Why is it that when Prophet talks about Allah, Abu Zar comes and says, Ya Rasulullah, tell me what you say. He says, I say La ilaha illallah. He starts to cry. What does he understand from this? There is something in his heart. The mawsul of this, the attachment of this word, Allah has played in our hearts. So because of that ma'rifah of the heart, we can say la ilaha illallah. We can understand la ilaha illallah. And it is because of this that people tend to go to Allah. Otherwise, when a prophet comes and speaks about Allah, if we don't know this Allah at all, you know, I talk to you about Fatimah al-Zahra now. You all know who Fatimah al-Zahra is. Therefore, when I talk, you have a sense of familiarity. But if I talk to you about someone who you do not know at all, It doesn't make any difference for you, whatever I say about them. Why it makes difference to us when someone talks about Allah, it brings tears to our eyes. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ Or وَإِذَا تُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُنَا تَرَى أَعْيُنَهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمِ When our ayat is read to them, you see that tears come. What brings those tears? It's something here attached. So the mawsool of La ilaha illallah, which is ma'rifatullah, Allah has placed in your heart. وَذَمَّنَ الْقُلُوبَ مَوْصُولَهَا I don't think we can find any philosopher or any theologian speak like this about Allah, about La ilaha illallah, in three short sentences. Okay, what else? So, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ كَلِمَةً جَعَلَ الْإِخْلَاسَ تَعْوِيلَهَا The reality of this is ikhlas, is known by ikhlas. The mawsool of this, how you know La ilaha illallah, is in your heart. وَأَنَارَ فِي التَّفَكُّرَ مَعْقُولَهَا It's not only action, it's not only heart, it is reason as well. The ma'aqul, the rational understanding of this, Allah has enlightened in your tafakkur, in your mind, in your intellect. You can argue, yes, that's how the Quran argues about God and presence of God, existence of God, argues with all these signs. So in tafakkur as well as in heart, as well as in action, you would see Allah has enlightened your minds as well. Now, this is the knowledge that I say has come from above. Fatimah al-Zahra was 18 years old. She hadn't studied anywhere. She hadn't studied in school or something. It's just like Maryam, when, of course, she was given that knowledge of supernatural by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This knowledge comes from above. And when it comes from above, as I said, it's inclusive, it is unifying. You know things very differently. You don't know only why things happen. You also know how, sorry, you don't know only how things happen. You also know why things happen. You see the reality of things, not the veneer. As the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, Allahumma arin al-ashya'a kama hi. Show me things as they are, not as they appear. Our knowledge is always as they appear. But the knowledge which comes from above is as they are. Inshallah, Allah enlighten our hearts with ikhlas, with sincerity, and with that knowledge which comes from above. And that knowledge which comes from above is only attainable by sincerity and by sidq and ikhlas, sincerity and truthfulness. And that is the true meaning of worship of Allah. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi tahirin.
Thank you very much. We'll now have some questions if there are any.
Assalamualaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Thank you for that lecture. I just needed a verification. Earlier, in the first half of the lecture, you mentioned an action requiring three things. Khashiyatullah, Sadiqan Niyya. What was the third thing? And what?
Wal Hasana. Khashiyatullah, Wal Niyyatu Sadiqa, Wal Hasana. Means whatever you do should be good.
And Khashiyatullah?
Khashiyatullah is that is that humbleness which you should always have when you talk to Allah, when you ask things from Allah. This is khashyatullah.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I think we'll end that then. Muhammad wa al-Muhammad, salawat.
Allahumma salam.